Hi, I'm Mario Martinez. I wanted to talk about a little bit of my testimony. I was raised and born in California, up in East LA. Let's just say I was raised in a real bad neighborhood, in a bad area. We call it the projects. I wanted to share as a kid growing up. I had my dad, my mom, my brother, my sister. And growing up was not really easy for me. My dad was an alcoholic. My mom was just a housewife. And my brother and my sister, we all had our own lives, of course. But growing up was pretty bad. We moved in this area called the Projects in East LA. And realizing there was a lot of gangs. There was gangs, there were drugs. It was just not a really good area for us. But I guess that's what my parents could afford at the time. We moved in, and it was kind of tough because you had to learn how to, I guess we call it tough, and which is, for us, we had to learn how to have respect. We had to teach others to give us respect, and let's put it that way, which there was no love, really. But, you know, I do remember a lot of things in my past and everything that I went through. First of all, I wanted to say that at the age of 10, as far as I can remember, where my dad used to come home drunk, beat us. This was not just every month. This was almost every day. For some reason, my brother and my sister were more like their favorite. And with me, I don't know what he had against me, but I will share that later on. He would always beat me. He would always do whatever he wanted with me. He would throw me out of the house. He threw me out of the house at the age of 10 years old. I was a kid. I didn't know no better. I had no love. My mother was my best friend mostly, but he just wasn't a way between my mom and I. He did not let my mom share any of her love with me. I guess he just hated me. Well, this is where it all started. The day he threw me out of the house is when I was 10 years old. I went out, I didn't know how to survive, I didn't know how to work, I didn't know how to do anything. I was only 10 years old. So I learned, I seen the gang members on there. It was a lot of Hispanics and blacks together. I seen that lifestyle, but I didn't really agree with it in my heart, but I just didn't know how else to survive. I seen them bringing in money. I seen them at the age of 13, 14, they had a car, nice cars. Let's just say they had money in their pocket because of drug selling. Well, I got into the business with them. I got involved, I started hanging out with them. And time there's when what they do is they observe you, see how you are, see the things you're gonna do, if you're gonna do what they say. Then I guess to them it's considered, okay, this guy's crazy enough to go ahead and join us. So then you get jumped in. You get jumped in and you're part of the family. They call the family now. And I guess for me, that was my family because I didn't have the love at home. You know, they took care of me. They gave me money. They gave me drugs. So I have money in my pocket. You know, of course, nobody learns how to do the bad things. I went out, I stole cars, I was a thief, I was a drunk, I was a drug addict, you call it, I was everything. Everything that was in the black book. When I was 10 at the time too, I wound up being locked up in juvenile hall. That was my first time being in jail, when I was 10 years old. I did 6 months in juvenile hall. And from there, of course, you know, young, and I guess we consider it dumb, not realizing. I thought I was a tough guy now because I was in jail. I did 6 months. During the 6 month period in there, you learned, you know, you have to fight, you have to move forward and be a tough guy because that's what you become. You become a gangster. You become to walk with a heart you don't care. There's no love in there. Plus with the pain and everything that you carry from your past and growing up, there's no love, so you become meaner. You become not to care. I would walk, and you know, me and buddies would hang out in the corners of the liquor store. And we'll wait for people to come and cash their checks. And when they walk out, we'll jump them. We'll jump them for their money because that's what we did. And we didn't care. So as I was growing up, you know, part of all of this not good stuff that we did in our past, I got introduced also with the Ouija board. I got introduced with witchcraft. I mean, witchcraft doesn't mean that you necessarily have to get in there and get dressed in black and start doing magic. You get introduced with witchcraft by the horoscopes, by doing things you're not even realizing what you're doing, what you're messing with. That's opening demonic doors that you're not even aware. So when you start messing with stuff like that, that's when these demons start getting around you and you start falling for these lies and telling you that that's power. So you just open a demonic door. So that's what happened to me. I got involved with these things. I hated my dad with a passion. I mean, I hated him because he would beat me. As I was growing up, the reason he would throw me out is because he was was able to hit my mother no more. He would come home and beat my mom. So he was no longer able to beat her. So I would jump in and we would fight. I would fight with him like he was just a regular person in the street, like he was my worst enemy. Am I proud of it? No, I'm not proud of it. But I wasn't going to allow him to hit my mom anymore. So he would beat us. But I would rather him beat me than my mother. So at one time, we got into it in the house, and we fought. I picked up a chair. I threw it over his head. And he knew that him being drunk, he wasn't going to have his way with me. So he ran to his room. As he ran to his room, I ran outside because I knew what he was reaching for. He was going for the rifle. And we lived kind of like in the second floor, so I had to run all the way down. By the time he went to the room, came back out, I was almost kind of halfway out. There was a gate, little gate that I had to turn. So I went into this gate, and as I'm turning, I can hear the shot fires at me. They were just fired, the gun, pop, 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 pop. As I'm turning the corner, I can hear the bullets backfire on the gate, pop, 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 pop. And I can hear the bullets passing through my ears. Anyways, I kept running. I was afraid. As I got to a hidden place, I hid from him because I thought he was going to be chasing after me. Well, I kind of started feeling something hot in my leg. And it just started itching. So I kind of lifted up my pants to see what was going on. And he had shot me in the leg. I was bleeding. I have the scar here in my leg, but I didn't think of anything about going to the hospital or anything. I just let it, whatever was going to happen. And to me, I was in trouble with the law and them knowing that what was going on and putting my dad in jail, that was just something for me that we were raised not to be snitchers. We were raised to be tough. So that's why I never really said anything about it. But it healed. It healed. The bullet kind of just skinned my leg. So it was just more flesh that healed with the flesh. But anyways, that was part of what he would do to me. There was another time, too, that we got into it. And he went in for the machete. He had a machete. And if I would not run out of that door when he had me in the corner, he swung the machete towards my neck. And that's when I got a chance to get out of the door. But he did hit the wall with the machete, because he was going for my head. So I escaped that one too. And, you know, like I said, there was a lot of things that were going on in my life. And I'm saying this regarding because these are the things that the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to me to speak for those of you that are out there struggling in this area also. And we need to confess everything out of our mouth into the light because God is light. And I'm saying this right now, and I'm going to say this right now. Because there's a lot of you out there that you guys feel shame in your hearts. That's a chain that the enemy has in your heart right now. And they're making you feel guilty that it's your fault. That if you say anything, you ain't going to have friends. They're going to think you're a disgusting person. But I'm gonna say this to prove the point. Also, a family of a friend of my dad's, which was a friend of a family, I was molested as a kid. That was something that really, really hit my heart. That was something that I'm not here for you guys to feel sorry for me or anything. I'm here because I want to thank God for what everything he's done. He set me free from that. That's why part of my walk, I wanted to commit suicide. That's why when me and my buddies would sit at a table and drink, we would play Russian roulette. We would get the bullet in there, we'll spin that gun, and we'll pick it up. I was so hurt, so I hated myself so bad that I couldn't wait for my turn to pick up that gun and put that trigger in my head. I couldn't wait if that bullet was gonna come out for me. But so little I knew that where I was gonna go. Because I didn't know. I knew there was a hell and I knew there was a heaven. And I hated God so bad because the enemy would speak to me, where's your God in this? And the reason I knew God was because people from the church would come and drive around in a bus in our neighborhood and they would come pick us up. And they'll try to invite us to church. That's why I knew something about Jesus. They will come up to me with their Bible and say, look it, Jesus loves you. I'll tell them, get away from me with that. I don't want to hear that. Talk to me when I'm sober. Well, when are you going to be sober, Mario? That's the point. I don't want to hear about it. So the enemy would talk to me, where is your God? Who is Jesus? Why isn't he there to help you? So what happened to me being molested is something that is why I hated myself. I was disgusted with myself. I felt it was my fault. Everything was my fault. It was hard for me to get through in life. And I got myself into the Ouija board. I got myself into some people that knew about witchcraft. And I started to experience with it. I didn't have the power that these supposedly witches and warlocks get, but I did have, and I will receive the finances, the women, and stuff that is not from God. When that was an open door, did I realize that it was kind of, oh man, I like this. And I hated God so bad because of the things that happened to me. I would say to myself, I would say, if I had a gun that can reach God, I would pull it and let him, and I would shoot him in his heart. These are the things I would say because the hate I had in me. I had no love. I didn't know better. And I didn't know, and I did not realize the things that I was saying about God. So as I kept going forward in my life, I wanted, there's times that my mom caught me in the closet trying to hang myself. And from that point on, my mom wouldn't leave me alone anymore. She couldn't even go to the market because the things that she seen. And I would cut my wrists, I would cut my hands, and part of this little, I guess, satanic walk that I had, and I would write 666 in the wall with my blood, I would write the pentagram, and yeah, it is power, the black magic is power, but we're not going to glorify and give the glory to Satan, because God deserves the glory. It's only one God, one power, and his name is Jesus. But you know what? We have to get out of these things. And God and realize that these things are, it's true, it's true. And I know there's a lot of people out there right now that are struggling, they're going through a lot. And don't let the enemy lie to you and say, don't open your mouth. Open your mouth, say something. But as I kept going and walking in my life, like I said, I hated my dad as well. There was times when he'll let me back in the house and he'll be asleep, because he was getting ready to go to work. and I was high, I would hear a voice. It's time. This is the way the voice will come to me. It's time. Get the gun. It'll solve a lot of your problems. Go in, point in the back of his neck, and pull the trigger. That's the voice that would speak to me and to kill my dad. And a lot of people, and I know a lot of you, but well, yeah, you was high, you was drugged up. No, no. This voice was real. This voice was true, what I would hear, to tell me to destroy my dad, kill my dad. And there was times I would go in with the rifle, and I already had it right behind his neck. And I'll snap out of it and come back out to the room and just put the gun away. There was other times that I would just go in and get a big kitchen knife and just wanted to go ahead and put it in his heart because of the pain and the hate I had in me and because being involved with this witchcraft and it's part of hate, it's part of sacrificing, not knowing much, but I was learning. But you know what? I just thank God I didn't do it. Something in me was stronger than that. You know, in Jeremiah, in the book of Jeremiah, it says, for the Lord has called you before placing you in your mother's womb, and out of your mother's womb he has called you. And he has a plan for you before he places in our mother's womb. That's why the things that I went through, that was that call I had. And as we were sitting there in the table playing Russian roulette, my buddies and I, we would actually put a bullet in there, spin it, put the gun down, take our shots, puff puff the evil weed. And one thing about this last, the last of the, almost the end of the night was that we would click it and click it. It was my turn, his turn, we'll grab it and click it. But for some reason, my buddy over here decided to go ahead and take my turn. And we were fighting about that because I wanted to take my turn. You know, not really thinking where we were going to go or how our lives was. We're just crazy and dumb and just hateful, really, in our hearts. We didn't care about anything. Anyways, I was fighting with my buddy because he took my turn. He wanted to take my turn. And I grabbed the gun from him because I wanted to take my turn. So finally, they grabbed the gun off our hands. He went outside with the gun and pointed up to the air and clicked it. And that's when the bullet came out. Pow! And we both stood looking at each other with this look like, really, like one of us would not have been here. But, you know, we didn't think nothing of it. We just, okay, life goes on. We move on. So as we continue to move forward with this crazy violent life, we will get in cars and go do our drive-bys and find people in the streets, go look for our enemies, just get out the car, fight, do whatever we can. We did drive-bys. Sometimes just because you don't pull the trigger and you get caught with it, you're gonna get that blame. No matter what, cops want everybody in. Everybody's going down for something. And if you're part of this gang, you're not gonna get a walk away from it free, even if you didn't do it. If you're what the words, the terms say, if you're down with the homies, you gotta go down with everything. If he's going to jail, you gotta go with him. Because if you don't go, then that means, you know, you said something to talk yourself out of this to the cop, or they consider you a rat. So there we go. That's when I got locked in. like I said, you know, I have been locked up half of my life, in and out. That's all I knew. That was my life. You know, the last time it was pretty hard because it's when you spend time in prison, and you know, to realize is that you think you was a tough guy, you think you know it all, but when you go here is when really that's when your softness, your caring, leaves everything stays at the gate, because now you're entering a real jungle. Real, you're in there with murderers, with rapers, with everything. You think you're tough, you think you're angry, you think you're crazier than them, there's crazier people out there than you. So as I went in there, you know, there's always going to be somebody in there that's not going to like you. They're going to look at you, they got plans for you no matter what. But if you're working in the outside with the gang, you got connections from the inside. So that's what helped me out, that I was taken care of, which everybody in there, basically Hispanic, black, whites, they all sit together. So of course we sit with the Hispanic, and because in there is not about gangs, it's about one big connection, which is the Mexican mafia. You got the white power, you got the guerrillas. So now you're connected to one big family. But if you're involved in the streets and you're making money for them, then you're welcome. Now you're graduated to something higher. Now you're getting introduced to something bigger. But in there, it's always going to be someone that's not going to like you. And you always got to be with somebody, someone with you. You got to watch your back. Somebody's got to watch your back. You got to watch their back. There has been times that I almost got my throat slit from 1 year to another year. I got scars, I got stab wounds because of that. But you learn how to fight and survive. It's almost how we all started from kids. From kindergarten, and you go all the way through high school, you graduate, you're done, you go to college, you become someone. And the streets, it's the same thing. As kids, you're being ordered to do what to do. Now you went to jail. Now you graduated from kindergarten. Which is called juvenile hall. And then you go to county, and then from county you go to prison. So there's no difference in the streets and in the world, how you live your life in an educational way than in the streets. It's just different with the violence, and you got a career going on in life. But yeah, there was many times that I almost got killed. And I thank God that God was always there with me. Zone, and maybe I never thank God for it, but because I thought I was a tough guy and I made it through. Coming out of this place, I continued to move in the streets, did what I had to do, my money, sold drugs, did drugs. Back to the same way. We say we're going to come out and change, but we don't. I believe it was a Friday. I was at home, and we all know Fridays. When Fridays come, it's party time. We go get dressed, we're getting ready to go out, party, hang out with the friends. But that Friday just seemed a little different. That Friday was just something about that Friday. I just didn't feel like going out. I didn't want to go out. I felt that if I was going to go out that night, I was not going to come back home. That was very, very heavy in me. a fear came over me, a fear I never felt before. You know, there goes friends knocking in the door, bum, 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 bum. Mario, come outside, let's go. Let's party. I couldn't answer the door. I couldn't speak. Something had my mouth shut. Something had me held down that there was no way I was going to answer that door. And the more they knocked on the door, the more heavier I felt I was not going to come home. I was just not going to come back home no more. And I started getting scared. So maybe half an hour later, finally my stubborn friends stopped. They finally got the hint, I'm not coming out, or I was in there. They couldn't understand either what was going on, but I stood home. I laid in my couch. It's the way I laid in my couch on my back. I fell asleep, I went to a deep sleep. When I fell asleep, I remember closing my eyes. And I remember it was about 9 o'clock that night. I opened my eyes. As I fell asleep, I opened my eyes again. That quick, just as it's almost like a blink. Close, open. And when I opened my eyes, what I noticed was that my face was stuck in the ceiling. My face was literally stuck up in the ceiling. So I'm trying to catch myself here, like, questioning myself, what was going on here? And as I look sideways, I can see my body laying in the couch. So I'm questioning myself, how come I can see my body? So I guess everybody knows how a balloon is, birthday balloons and whatnot. It has the healing in there, and you grab it with the string, and you let it go, and it bounces up and down on the ceiling. Well, it was, my soul was almost that way. I push myself down, grab my hand on the wall, and I push myself down, and I'll come back up to the wall and bounce my face. I did that 2 times. The third time, when I'm trying to push myself down, I can see my body again. And it was like, it was just like in a peaceful, restful manner. So I start spinning around the ceiling, slowly, start going around in circles. And I'm going a little faster and faster. You know, there's nothing in the ceiling, so I'm trying to get a hold on to something, grab on to something, and I just can't get a hold of anything. And I'm going faster and faster and faster. And as the fastest I'm going, now I'm starting to hear these wicked laughs, like demons. They're laughing. I can hear them clearly going, ee! Just wicked. As I'm going faster, I don't know if you guys ever seen movies about a time machine. I just, when the time machine disappears and it comes back, well, as I was going faster, that's what I heard. And I find myself in this big, big, dark place. Dark, dark. There's trees, dead trees. The ground, the sand was like gray, dirty gray. Whatever was behind me, I was able to see these things because, and there was a time where it's so pitch black, you can't even see your hand in front of your face. It's so dark in there, you can't see anything. But whatever was behind me, I couldn't look back. But I can see in front of me. Everything was dead, trees, and it was just dry. There was no love, there was nothing, just dead. And I'm moving forward slowly. And I remember, not remember, but what I seen in my spirit when I was out of my body. There was 5 demons that ran around me. And they were covered in black, almost like witches and warlocks covered themselves. Some of them were different. Some of them have face of like rats. Some look like bats. You guys see these movies, these Hollywood movies, that the demons, how demons, they describe demons. See, Hollywood is based on the Antichrist. Witches and warlocks work for Hollywood. So they see demons, it's why they come out with these movies, because that's exactly how they look. So they make them as a mask and models, and they make movies like that. That's exactly how demons look. But these things are more 10 times stronger, 10 times bigger. Some of them have yellow eyes, green eyes, red light eyes. Not beautiful little green, red light like Christmas lights. These eyes were evil, wicked. You can feel the hate, how they look at you. You can sense that hate. That hate is so overwhelming that not even a human being in this earth has that much, that kind of hate. It would be overwhelming for us. It would automatically explode your heart with such an ugly, overwhelming hate. As I'm going forward, something caught my attention. My arms were straight out. And another thing that caught my attention was that I wasn't walking. I was gliding. And as I'm gliding, I had these chains on me. Chain with the ball on the end. They were so heavy, I wanted to put my hands down, but I just couldn't. I was taking that pain. And I remember seeing these demons, and I kept saying, where am I? Let me go. They wouldn't say nothing to me, but they'll look at me, and they'll laugh. They were giggling. That's all they did. And I can see them. They had real long, long fingernails, real powerful, sharp nails, like razors. But they wouldn't respond to me. They were just giggling at me, laughing at me. So as I'm moving forward, I start seeing this big, big black tunnel. This tunnel was huge, and I can hear the sound of this tunnel. And I'm starting to enter this tunnel, and my hands are so over heavy. I need to put them down, and I'm in pain already. I just can't, but I'm still gliding into this tunnel. As I'm beginning to go into the tunnel, halfway into this tunnel, this terrible smell starts to come out of this tunnel. A smell that I wanted to die. This smell was just horrible, horrible. If this smell was on the earth, we would die, because that's how terrible this smell is. There's no air in there. There's nothing. So I had to pass this smell. And I see a tiny little light at the end of this tunnel. And I said to myself, oh, okay, well, as soon as I get to that end of that tunnel, that little light, I'm gonna be safe. But I wanted to die. I felt ugly, death. And the word of God says this is the second death. It's just the beginning of your second death. As I'm going into this tunnel, I finally went to the end of the tunnel. I didn't see that little light no more. Everything was just, I didn't see the demons no more. So I'm just standing there, okay. And then suddenly these flames just rose from the ground up. Real hard. That's the sound that I heard. You know how we open our curtains in the morning? So that's the way the flames split. When the flames split, a voice told me, walk forward, go in there. So I walked forward. When I went forward, there was a lot of screams. There was a lot of fire. I seen a lot of people. There was a lot of people screaming. Before I go forward, I'm not saying this to scare you guys. I'm not here to scare anybody. I'm just telling you, this is the true what happens after death. I seen all this. I seen rivers of fire. People are burning. There's been people burning there for many, many, many years, hundreds of years. People are their flesh burns. They burn, they burn, they burn, and the flesh falls. And your bones get nice and toasty and black and gray. And when it's done, then the flame, your skin, your flesh starts growing back on you. And then the flames start again. And I also seen maggots crawling through your flesh, through your, in your bones. And they're eating you. They're eating your flesh. It makes no difference. Just picture yourself now in the earth. If you have bugs or maggots eating your flesh, how will that feel? But you're in hell already. There's nothing you can do. You have to, that's the torture. That's your everlasting torture life in there. I seen teenagers for the disobedience of their parents. I seen pastors, because it said in the word, for they have robbed me of my tithing. I seen Christians because they didn't want to get up and do anything for God. And then Christians doing things at home, thinking that nobody will see them. I keep repenting, repenting, but they just never got out of doing what they kept doing and playing with God. They were either warm or either cold, but they're lukewarm. They just kept playing and playing and playing. But the flames there rise higher on Christians. Demons torture you in different way, even sexually. They can tear your head. They can sexually attack you. They can cut you. They can stab you. They will tear you to pieces, and you're still alive. You can feel everything that's going on. I seen witches, I seen warlocks, because Satan told them that he was going to promise them their kingdom if they serve him, which it was a lie. All he wanted was your soul. One soul is a million souls to the Lord. That's how valuable your soul is. As I'm walking through these dirt road, there's fire and there's screaming, there's shouting, and people are saying that, let me out. Let me out. I want to do right. I want to do right this time. I promise to do right. Let me go out and tell the world and let them know that this is a real place. Hell is real. But it's too late, because once we have our opportunity and our chances, God's so merciful. He's so lovable. He gives you chance after chance after chance. And if we don't take that chance, that's where we're going to go. There was also people in there because they had no love and no forgiveness for their others. It says, pray for your enemies. It says in the Word of God, if you have no love, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. If you have no forgiveness, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven, because God is pure love. Every one of these people that were being tortured and burned. There's no sleep, there's no rest, there's no food, there's no water. You know how it feels sometimes we don't go without water for a while? Man, we need water, even though we don't like water, but man, we need water. I want some water. Food, rest. You ever been, when night falls, you're tired, you need to sleep? There's no sleep there. These demons go in there day and night, and they torture you in every which way. There's never no rest for you. Burning, fire. I mean, that's the least of your problems, of you sleeping, not drinking, or it's the torture that you're going through with these demons. And as I begin to walk down this trail, there was rivers, but rivers of fire. And as I can see inside the rivers, I can see these little eyes looking up at me. And it almost appeared that as they were going up and down, it looked like they were chained up together. And they were walking, going up and down as they wanted to get out. But you could hear their screams, screams. And you can see them reaching out with their hands. You can see the skeleton. And then God knows the thoughts before we think them. So this is the worst that I would receive. Those were the lesbians. Those were the homosexuals. These are the gay men. that were chained up together, walking in these rivers of fire. Some of them wanted out, but it was too late. And as we go, and as I'm going, I'm walking through this road, and all this fire and all these rivers. And I start seeing a lot of crosses and fire all over the place. And you see demons poking their privates with these swords, poking their privates all the way in and coming out through their chest in different direction, but they start in through their privates. And the word it says that masturbation is a no-no. It's a sin. It says, cut up your hand and throw it into the fire. It is better than your hand to burn than your whole body. Those were the people that had that were changed up, that they were in that curse, that they could not get out of pornography, masturbation, sexual desires that the enemy will bring to them. And let me tell you something that demons will tell them, will speak in there. Demons call us, we're stupid humans. That's the way they talk. That's the way they think of us, that we're stupid because we're so dumb to listen to every little lie that the enemy says. And I've seen a lot of these Christians in there for that. They say, well, a lot of Christians say, hey, I heard the devil tell me this. I heard the devil. Well, why can't we hear God? But because the bondage that we're in, the sin that we're in, and also for not loving each other. Not loving each other, because I went back to that. We will not enter the kingdom of heaven if there's no love and no repentance or forgiveness. There's Christians in there because they could not forgive. They just would not forgive. God says, if I have forgiven your sins and remember them no more, why can you forgive? But now it was too late. They wanted to forgive. They're screaming in there, I forgive you. I forgive you. Get me out of here. I want to be set free. I want to do what's right. I want to go speak the word. I just want to live my life for you. But it says it's too late. It is too late. And I could continue to walk through this. I wanted to be out. I was so afraid already. I didn't want to see no more. I did not want to see no more. I just wanted to bow down in the corner there or wherever and drop. And I wanted to close my eyes and I didn't want to see nothing no more. But whatever it was, it controls you. I was controlled to see and to move forward. In our carnal minds, we think that, oh, well, I can fight them off. I can run from them. No, there's nowhere to run. There's nowhere to hide. And you cannot fight these things. They're 10 times bigger than you, 10 times stronger than you. And there's no way you would ever get out of these things. You would always burn. Witches in cells. There's cells in there, just like in prison. And everybody that was in these cells are the ones that created more crime, more sin in their lives. I also seen warlocks and witches where they were biting their flesh. They're trying to drink their blood because there's no water in there. They figured if I bite my flesh off too, I can drink blood. So that's what I thought. But these are the words that came to me when I seen witches and warlocks biting their flesh. And these are the words is because when they were on the earth, they sacrificed humans. They sacrificed animals. And they drank blood. And they ate the flesh of the sacrifice they did. So that's why they were in there burning and torching and trying to eat their own flesh. As I continue to go forward, I pass that. And every cell that's in there, there's different witches and warlocks for the sin. And you can see this little old lady there. And she looked towards the door out of the cell. And her face was changing, different people. And that's what she did in the world. She would transform herself into different people. And she was using Satan's power to destroy Christians, to destroy the churches. But the cells are almost like up in the on the earth, prisons. Where there's a lot of cells because you also commit a crime up there. There's no difference down there that you commit a crime. And demons go in the same way, and they torture you, and they burn, and they do whatever they want with you. And there's no way out, no way out. And I kept going as I kept walking. I came to this room, this one big, ugly, dark, gray room. But you can hear, you can still hear all these screams. And there was a coffin in the middle. There was a big coffin, a big black coffin. And there was demons dancing around this coffin. And there was a hole in the middle of the coffin, like in the center of the, almost towards the heart. And as they were dancing, they were kept singing, "We worship you, Satan. We worship you, Satan." And I can hear almost rock and roll music, just as us that I used to listen to Pink Floyd and Led Zeppelin and all this rock and roll music, because that's also satanic. Rock and roll was created by Satan. And I can hear this music, but instead the words were different. They were worshiping Satan. They were saying, "Satan is our Lord, Satan is the Lord." And as they kept going around the circle in this box, they kept poking the hole, poking the hole, poking the hole, day and night. And I could hear somebody screaming and screaming and screaming and screaming. And there was a pastor in there. A pastor, because he was robbing God, for they robbed me of my tithing. Even not just the pastors, but there's a lot of Christians that rob God of their tithing. They don't give God what needs to be given. God is not a waitress. He's a king. And when we love God, we give what belongs to God. But this pastor was there because he had a big house. He had big Rolex. He had cars. And because he was robbing God. So that was his eternal life there, being tortured by these demons. As I keep going by, and the crosses that I seen, there was a lot of people being tortured, not only in their private parts because of masturbation and pornography and their sexual desires, but there was also people on the crosses being tortured, and these were the Christians, what they call the hypocrites. And God doesn't like hypocrites. They were doing things out of, not because of their heart. They were doing things to look good in front of people. But deep down in their hearts, they hated them. They hated each other. There's Christians that get up in the morning and say, "God, please don't let this person be there today." Really? God's going to hear that prayer, right? God is love. And for us Christians, we need, remember, we're not perfect, but we have to do the right thing. We have to love. We have to have that love of God in our hearts in order to move forward and to listen to what God wants us to do. Love is the key. Love is powerful. Love is what breaks the enemy chains. Even men and women in there because of their marriage, the lusting, the fornication, the adultery, the pornography, the sexual desires that they had, which is vanity. It's bondage with the enemy. God created our marriage to be clean and pure for Him. A lot of Christians that they were getting couples involved in their marriage and then repent. A lot of people in there that were screaming and shouting, they had it worse. I mean, they were really being tortured in a lot of ways because of the disgusting things they were doing in their bedroom sexually with animals and whatnot. And I kept going and going. I finally seen this top hill that I'm going up to this hill. After seeing all these crosses. And the thing that got me was the screams and the demons that were so humongous. And they see you, the way they want to terrorize you, the way they want to just destroy your life. And even I seen parents that we need to discipline the kids to be the priest of your house, the woman praying of your house, and to lead our children to Christ. And they didn't do their job, because that was our job. So it's basically you're telling your son and your daughter, go to hell, I'm going to heaven. So where did you wind up going for not doing God's will? So I'm climbing up this hill already. I can't stand it, I can't see no more. I just wanted some water because my mouth was so dry. And I can feel the heat. I can feel the fire. As I'm coming up to this big hill, I finally came to the end of this hill. And everything closed from behind. And I'm staying there, and I'm there standing already with this. My mind is traumatized already. I'm already, I don't know what's going to happen anymore. All I know is that I was glad that I was not seeing anything anymore. And then a big angel, 7-foot angel, beautiful angel with big blonde hair. No wings, just a white garment. This angel had a big sword in his hand. And he called my name. He said, Mario. Mario, he had to call me 2 or 3 times because I was so afraid. I didn't even want to move one hand because I didn't know what was going to grab me. And I looked up to him. He said, Mario, do you know where you're at? And I looked at him and I said, no. He said, if today was your time, this would be your portion. This is where you would spend eternal life. This is hell. He said, this is hell. He said, who's your God? And I said, I don't know. And I remember these two people by the name of Ronnie and Mike. There was the two Christians that would come out of the bus and go and pick up the little kids and pick us up for church. When he came up to me with the Bible and said, look, Mario, Jesus loves you. This is what they will tell me. So a little window opened up. And I seen both of them coming at me. Look, Mario, Jesus loves you. When they said Jesus, the window closed. And the angel spoke to me again and said, who is your God? I said, Jesus. He said, scream the name of your God. And I screamed it real loud. Jesus! And it echoed through the tunnels. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And that's when I came back into my body. And I opened my eyes, and I couldn't breathe. I was catching my breath. And I was so afraid. I didn't want to sit up. I didn't want to do anything because I didn't know if these things were going to get me. I was just afraid. The lights were right there. I could just turn the lights on, and I couldn't move. I stood there. I sat up finally, and I had my head down. I was bowed up. And the words that came to me was, Lord, forgive me. And I got on my knees and I remember that. And I said, and I picked up my hands and I said, Jesus, please forgive me of all of my sins. I repent. I repent for everything, God. I said, I don't want to go. I don't want to go to this place. Please forgive me, I said. And then that night, I remember a little buzz, like a buzzing noise or from the bottom of my feet, inside my feet. Zzz, all the way up to my head. Zoop! Came out. And from that point on, 19 years from now, the Lord delivered me from drugs, from alcohol, from tobacco, from sin. We're not perfect. We fall short. But once we love God, we become to hate sin just as God hates sin. He loves you is the sin that he hates. Just have you ever seen your dog come back to his throw up? You ever seen a dog when he throws up and he licks his vomit? Doesn't that look gross? That's the way God sees our sin. The sin is what he hates. But from that point on, God delivered me. And that's when I started walking with the Lord. That's when I knew I had a call from him.
Yes. We're gonna do a change in his outfit real quick. Okay? One second.
I want to talk about how I thank God. I want to thank God. God is good. God is awesome. I want to thank him for giving me a second chance in life, of getting me and pulling me out of the pits of hell. I want to say now, in 2004, this is another testimony about heaven. I want to let you guys know a little bit about heaven. I told you guys about hell already. And I want to glorify and give him the glory because I love God so much. In 2004, I believe in December, the 12/4 of 04, I was in my room. This is already walking into the Lord, serving God faithfully, and experiencing the fire of God and the Spirit of God, and experience the healing in his power and in his miracles. This was also one of my prayers, asking God, I want to see your heavens. I want to see your heavens. In 2004, that night I was praying, and I went to bed that night. At about 4 o'clock in the morning, I remember it's about 4 in the morning, I was asleep. I heard a voice call me. A voice woke me up saying, Mario, Mario, Mario. And I'm starting to wake up little by little. I opened my eyes little by little, and I see this real, real bright light in the corner of my room. And I see, and finally, as I'm starting to wake up, it keeps calling my name. And I see this real tall angel, 7-foot angel. This angel was the same angel I seen in hell, where he spoke to me and told me that this will be my portion. The angel that had the sword in his hand, this was the same angel I seen. He was standing there with such a smile. And he said, Mario, he says, you have been sent by God. And you have been appointed with the Lord. And I got up and I sat in my bed. And next thing you know, my spirit shot out of my body, straight up to the heavens. And as I'm going straight up to the heavens, I can see my house. And I look down to my house, and it's starting to look real small. And I can see my family asleep in my house. God knows your thoughts before you think them. And it says, and the Lord said, and I can hear the voice says, worry not, my son, for they're in the palm of my hands. And it was like a lightning. So I got up to the heavens. And I was walking forward. And there was this big, big cloud in front of me. And it was like a door. And a beautiful girl came out of there. And there was an angel as well. And she had this beautiful smile. And she didn't say nothing to me. She just kind of waved in. And then it came to me what the word of God says. Be careful because Satan can come as a beautiful angel. So I had to kind of pause and say, wait a minute. Maybe this is a trap. But when the Spirit of God was all over me and his amazing love, and then the voice said, come in. For all sheep know all sheep know my voice, he says. And I knew that was God's voice because I heard God's before. I heard his voice before. And as I entered through the other side of this cloud, I see this beautiful, beautiful place. There's gates in the front. And it speaks in the word of God as well, how there's rubies and jewels and diamonds in it. Just beautiful. These gates had rubies. They had jewels. They had pearls. I mean, it was the most beautiful thing I ever seen. As I entered to the gate, and to my left-hand side, there was other angels. We call them angels because they're in heaven. There's actually, they look like people like us, but with white garments and sandals. Yeah, remember something. In the Bible, it speaks about angels having wings. But these angels are not the angels that you think they have wings. These angels are the most highest angels that God has. The ones with the all the eyes and the different faces. I mean, if those angels will come down here, we will clear this room up in a second. Because that's how ugly they will look to us. We are here to serve. God came to the world to serve, and it makes it, we also are servants. So we serve people. So when we go home, we become servants of God, because that's what we are, servants of God here on the earth. So they have their garments. So now they're servants. So these are the people that come and serve us now on the earth. So I seen them, and I seen beautiful benches, nothing but pearl, made out of pearls. I mean, if you don't know about gold, if you don't know about jewels, let me tell you, you by seeing these jewels in heaven and seeing these pearls, you will know what they are, because I don't know how you know it, you just know it. Just as us that we walk prophetically. How do we know it? It's because God's with us. It's because we see through God. God, we allowed God to use us. How do we know the thoughts? Because we're used by God. But I just knew what it was. The pearls, the jewels. So there was this angel, he had the Bible open. It was ministering to these other angels that were sitting there. He was still ministering to them. Because if we don't get it here, you're going to get it up there. That's how merciful and lovable God is, that he still gives you that chance to get it. So as I look forward, I've seen a lot of beautiful rivers. Rivers, I mean, this water was so pure and clean, crystal clean. It speaks in the Word of God about the living water. Let me tell you, this was the living water. And there was beautiful angels all over, around the rivers, and their smiles, and, you know, they had their hands in the water, and they're just like, I mean, you think you had a vacation? No. Wait until we go home. You're gonna live such a life that it's overwhelming with his love. See, in the churches, when we come to church, people are like, oh my God, I hope so soul's not gonna be there. Oh my God, I guess if I have to go say hi to her or him in heaven, these angels greet me. They greet me with such an amazing love. The love is so overwhelming. A smile always. There's no sickness. You don't feel nothing but love. And your smile never leaves you. That's why in the earth here it says, if God lives in you, why don't you smile? Why don't you have that joy if God lives in you? And up there in heaven, everybody's smiling. Everybody's happy. It says, I would fill you with love, joy, and peace. That's the heaven right there. Love, joy, and peace. As I look to my right-hand side, I seen this big mountain. A mountain, nothing but gold, solid gold. A gold that you will never see in this earth. My left-hand side, there was this other mountain. Silver, nothing but silver. We're talking about mountains here. This is the same mountains that we have. When you go out and see mountains, that was so beautiful, so glow, so just sparkly, shiny gold and silver. And as I look to the front, I seen a big giant playground, a big beautiful playground for children. There was a lot of children in this playground. There was angels standing in each corner of this playground, and what they were doing there, they were standing watching these little kids with little garments, playing in the swings, the chains made out of gold, the swing made out of a crystal, the slide was gold. I mean, everything about this playground was made out, is based on gold and silver, and pearls, and sand. I don't know if you ever heard of clean sand. But this sand was so pure, crystal, white, clean. It was so clean. I mean, beautiful. Well, I want to say a point to these children here. And this is when God starts speaking. This is what God was identifying everything in his heavens. Those children are for you ladies or anyone that have lost a children or abortions. God's taking care of your baby. But it's through your repentance through the Lord. If you repent of your sins, God will forgive you. And then when you go home, you have a baby to take care of in heaven. But everything is so amazing. It's so beautiful. And in the temple, I seen a temple, God's temple, the people, the temple. And there was a big solid throne. A big solid throne. I mean, this throne was just solid, solid gold with rubies. I mean, it was an amazing, beautiful throne. I didn't see God on it, but I knew that was God's throne because it's so solid and you could just see. And you could see it was right in the middle of the temple with the people. And I start hearing a lot of beautiful music, beautiful music. And I'm looking around, where is this music coming from? And you start hearing singing. Holy, holy, holy. They're just holy, holy. Such a beautiful notes, music that doesn't just ring to your ears. The music comes directly. It comes into your heart, the love. It's play with love because God is love. And I couldn't figure out where this music was coming from because I didn't see anybody with any instruments or anything. So a voice speaks to me. Look to your left, my son. And I looked to my left. There was a lot of beautiful flowers, a lot of roses, living, everything lives. And the word of God, I believe in Isaiah 43, where it says, rejoice and glorify my name, for even the animals praise my holy name for the water that I sent upon the deserts. Everything that God creates, it lives and praises God. But when I looked to the flowers and to the roses, they were singing and worshiping God. The music was coming from them. And that's how beautiful they were creating and praising God. So as I keep hearing the music, it was just an amazing movement, just the fullness of the Spirit of God, the fullness of love, the way the angels greet you over there. And then I walked forward, maybe about 10 feet. And I looked to the front, and there was these big, 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 beautiful mansions. Beautiful, beautiful mansions. I mean, you think we want to live like the rich and famous here? No. You think they live it rich? No, my brothers and sisters. Wait until we go home. That's living it rich. Everything is open over there. Your treasures are there. Everything in your home is created the way your heart desires. But it's all made out of gold. The streets of gold, it says in the word of God, for there are streets of gold. Let me tell you, it's true. The streets of gold. You'll be walking in the streets of gold. In the houses of the pastors, the houses, and let me tell you, the houses of the prophets. Oh, my goodness. I wish I could have stood there, but let me tell you, when I seen the homes, and I can see everyone that's just so lovable, so peaceful, and then suddenly I hear trumpets. I see these angels just pop trumpets out, and they were about that long, and they start blowing trumpets. And then I hear voices. The king is coming. The king is coming. And everyone starts to bow. Everybody starts to drop to their knees. And as they were screaming, the king is coming, I see something coming from a distance. Very, very bright. Very bright. I mean, the light is not a disturbing light that you see here and it's going to disturb. This light was such an amazing, peaceful light that you can see. But I couldn't see his face. I can see from his chin, not almost from his mouth down, but I couldn't see his eyes. He came up to me, and I fell, and I was crying. And he says, "Rise, my son." And I got up. And I can see his sandals, and I can see his robe, his white garment. When he said, "Rise," to me, he picked his hands, he put his hands in front of me like this. And he says, "Rise." When he went, "Rise," I seen hose in his hands, and I seen his sandals, and I seen the hose in his sandals. And that's when I knew that was my father. And I rose and I stood there and I couldn't see his face, but I can see just his mouth, his beard, his hair to here. And he said to me, "My son," he said, "my son," he says, "I have ordered me a prophet." He says, "I have called you before placing you in your mother's womb, and out of your mother's womb I have called you. And I will move you into the nations. And you will let my people know that there is a heaven and there is a hell." He says, "Fear not for what they think, for the rest is in the palm of my hands. But let them know that I'm at the gate and my angels are at the gate preparing their horses and sharpening their swords. Because I'm coming home soon for my people. But let my lost and my broken know that I love them. And that I'm coming for them. And I want them to know that I love them. And I want them to come to repentance, because I don't want them to go to hell. I will put the words in your mouth, my son, and when you open your mouth, I will speak through you." He says, "Go, my son, go, and let my people know, and my lost know that I love them, and I'm coming soon." And I said in my thoughts, "He knows our thoughts before we think them. I don't want to come back." And he said, "Your time is not yet, my son, but soon you will see me face to face." He says, "Now go and let my people know that I love them." And then with the palm of his hand, he touched my forehead, and I went back. And when I went back, I looked, I can see my body, and I went into it instantly. Boom! And I went right into my body. And I woke up, and I was filled with the power with the Holy Spirit. I was filled with an amazing love, with an amazing joy. The love that he gave me for people, and for the lost, and for the hungry. We learn because of God. If it wasn't for God, we wouldn't have that love. But I thank God that he poured that love in me, that I'm willing and able to go out there and at least to give the lost and the homeless and those that are broken to hug them, just like we love our children and hug them and love them. We stank once. We were full of sin, and God still hugged us and loved us. Romans 5:8 says, "For he loves us even though we're still sinners." They stink, yeah, because they didn't shower, but they have hearts. They need love. So we go and hug them too, with the love, the way God loves us. So when I came back into this, I woke up, and I was praising and glorifying God that day. I could not sleep. I had to go to work the next day. But I could not wait to tell everybody what I seen and what I experienced. I worked at a place where there was nothing but Mormons. And because of that power that God gave me in that fullness of the fire of God and his authority, I thank God and give him the glory that he was willing to use me. That by the time God was done with me in that job, every Mormon was no more Mormons. Because they all came to the truth of God, the salvation of God. They repented. And I tell you that because there was a lot of them that I got and I stood in touch with when I left from Reno, Nevada. They all serving now the right. They got into the right church to serve God. And Revelation is Revelations 20:15 says, if your name is not written in the book of life, you shall be cast into the lake of fire. So the Lord spoke and said, we have a job to do. It is us that make it hard. God's job is easy. I want to pray right now, and I want to call a repentance for those of you out there tonight, today, are struggling with porn, struggling with curses, struggling with alcohol, struggling with hate or unforgiveness. In the Bible, it speaks in Revelations 20:15, if your name is not written in the book of life, you should be cast into the lake of fire. If you have no love and no forgiveness, you will be cast into the lake of fire. You will not enter the kingdom of heaven. God gives you chances after chances after chances. If you don't know Jesus right now, and if you're listening to this CD, this DVD, I challenge you right now, because it says in the Word of God, tomorrow is not promised. If you wish to die today, where do you think you will go? Where do you think you will go? Well, I have Jesus in my heart, I repent, but where are you sure that's where you're going? Do you have forgiveness? Do you have love? Not just friends, not just members from the church, but your families. A lot of families that come and slam doors and reject you, and people reject you, but you know what? Forgive them for that. Forgive them for that, for they do not know better. But you come into the glory of God today and repent. You become new. You become new. I tell a lot of people my testimony about heaven and hell and about me being in a gang, and they tell me, you know what they say? You being in a gang? How's that? You know why they can't see that? And I don't look like a gang member no more? Because in the Word of God, it says, when we accept Jesus, we become brand new in Him. So I became brand new with God, because that old Mario has died a long time ago. And we become new to walk forward and to love others and to forgive those. I forget my father, my earthly father, I forgave him. I forget my father. Well, everything he did to me, I forgave him. I prayed and I prayed and I prayed, and you know what? In Mark 17:16, it says, for they honor me with their lips, but their heart's far from me. So I thought, I said, Lord, I forgive him, I forgive him, I forgive him. God said, no, you have not forgiven him. And to one day, God pulled that root out of my heart. Boom. And he pulled it, and I screamed, and I shouted, and I didn't care who hurt me at the church. And then the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, now you have forgiven your father. But you know what's so awesome about that? That before my father left Kansas City, Missouri, he went down to the front of the altar, and he repented. He asked God to forgive him for his sins. My dad's still alive now, and he has been delivered from alcohol. But he has got to forgive him. That's what made me happy. That what glorified me. That what made God happy too. That was one of my main prayers, that my dad one day will come to the Lord and repent because of this place called hell. I don't want anyone to go there. No one. No one. It's not for us. And this place is true. This place is true, my people, my friends. I'm not here to scare you. I'm not speaking out of my, just because it's a story. This is the reality of what happens. The day you die, you either go to heaven or you go straight to hell. We follow Jesus or we go to hell. It's basically simple. I'm not here to speak selfish, to be mean. I'm here to tell you the truth. What's going to happen if the day you die? today if you die, will you be sure? Do you know exactly where you will go? Will you go to heaven or will you go to hell? I just ask today that you will bow your heads and let me lead you into this repentance. Heavenly Father, we just come today in the name of Jesus. And I ask that you will forgive me of all of my sins. As far as I can remember, forgive my sins. Make me the person that you called me to be. I accept you as Lord of my life. I believe you died and rose. Father, come today. I let you in my heart. Have your way with me. Have your way. Forgive me, cleanse me, and cover me.